on the last point, yeah. 87 million Nigerians extremely poor, and you say the economy is doing better.
Well, the reality is that you measure poverty on an ongoing basis. Okay, so that a point, yes, like you said, the Brookings Institution came up with that number. It's a dynamic thing. And poverty is not a problem you solve overnight. And I'll give an illustration here. Now, one of the strongest green economies in the world, and that is that of China in the last 30 years, you find that it took them that much period to bring 23.1% of their population from below to above the poverty line, but by doing certain things, which are those things that we are saying our government should be doing. Now, and of course, I would say in the last 10 years, since 2008, is one thing I've advocated for, and that is you need to invest in infrastructure. And that talks to, I call infrastructures enablers, and of course, you need to invest in health and also education. Once you have those three right, you will get people above the poverty line, and of course, also expand the middle class, which of course represent the spenders. But in case of Nigeria, there are a lot of rigidities, as we call it in economics, which is to say that people become more wealthy, okay? But instead of spending this wealth on goods made in Nigeria, they are spent on imported goods. And so you find that the wealth has been transferred offshore and therefore creating jobs abroad. And that's where the disconnect is.
But, you know, for the indices, other than, you know, the regular ones you economists use on a regular basis, what you get out there on the streets, what people always tell you is that, look, some of them, they give you that picture that all is not well with their pockets. So they think that there's been a, it's going south for some of them. So is that not an indication? And to what extent can we rely on those?
Well, I will say again, one can fault how poverty itself is measured. And this is going again to the same roadside. We call it roadside economics. A man claims he earns 15,000 in a month. Question is, if that is all he has available, how does he survive on that? How does he pay for transportation from where he lives to work? 20 days in a month. How does he take care of feeding his family? How does he cater for accommodation and other needs? So you find that in reality, the system has a lot of activities going on that are not captured in the formal economy. We call it the informal economy. So what people report and measure poverty on is what happens in the formal economy. But there's a complete disregard of the informal one, which is really is the support that makes people survive in this environment. But when they paint the picture for you, they paint the picture of, I earn only so much. So, but there's quite a lot they do. There are still so many of them that engage in activities that don't come on the table, so to say. I came across an analysis this week. Very simple one. Okay, people engage in producing plantain chips. They sell in traffic jams all over Lagos. Somebody took a count and went around Lagos and estimated maybe about 1,000 boys hawk this stuff in the traffic. But when they were interviewed, came with an estimate of daily sales of between 80 and 100 million naira. Now extrapolate that. In Lagos alone. That's about 2 billion naira revenue from plantain chips in 1 month. And so you now see some foreigners looking at that and say, what's wrong with you Nigerians? You can't see that. And they are looking at coming to invest in that, aiming to get 20% of the market share, and they'll be too cool with that.
And we know that hawking is illegal in Lagos states.
And that is just one item, and there are several others.
But, you know, if you look at some of the issues that they raise about budget, budget performance,
that's right.
The kind of impact it has on the average person out there. So for 2018 budget, in terms of its implementation,
that's right.
What... Is it a past mark? Has it impacted on the economy? And how?
Well, I will say it has impacted on the economy for this reason. One is one critical element, and this is something I've emphasized in managing the economy since 1970 till date, and that is the exchange value of the naira. Now, it has been proven through several researches and evidence-based analysis that anytime the naira loses value, it washes into all prices. And that, of course, affects the standard of living, and almost every other thing. So for me, the critical thing is, if you are able to stabilize the exchange value of the naira, to some extent, you'll be able to deal with some other issues.
But we know we had a lot of turbulence this year about the stability of that particular area. So there was this argument about the monetary and the fiscal policies being at cross purposes, they couldn't get themselves together. That also happened this year.
Well, I don't see it that way because my data doesn't tell me that. And of course, these are official data, like I always tell government anyway, that we don't create our own data. We take data from the government, then we interpret. But what the data tells us primarily is that the naira has been stable in all market segments for foreign exchange. And for me, that is where it starts from. Now, when you take it from there, now you look at inflation rate. Yes, for the period from January to August, it trended downwards, went up, came down again, and picked up again in November. So we can see the pattern there. But again, CBN will say, well, we are comfortable with that because for us, we are looking at that vis-a-vis encouraging foreign investments anyway in terms of the implication for bond prices. Now, if you look at lending rate, yes, it's still worrisome, double digits, and of course, lending rate at 20-something percent is still a challenge to producers. But the question again is, if you dimension the economy, agriculture, about 29.3% of the GDP in the last GDP figures, then look at the other five major sectors of the economy. You will find also manufacturing there with about 8.4% of production, activities, and value created. Look at ICT, trade is also there, real estate, and of course, mining and quarrying. Yeah. Now, these all together account for about 80% of the economy, which means some things are happening for these sectors to be growing, because prior to 2018, they accounted for 77% of activities in Nigeria.
And Mr. Bayo Rotimi has since joined us. Thank you for coming on today.
Always a pleasure and compliments of the season.
Same to you too.
Let's continue with Dr. Biodun Adedipe. We just played something, some of the initiatives of the former finance minister, Ms. Kemi Adeosun. And other than whistleblower policy, there was also the one on Eurobond offerings. And you mentioned that infrastructure is one important thing that governments, especially Nigeria, need to work on. And major headlines were power, rails, bridges, and many of this. But do you think these projects justifies government's huge external borrowings, Eurobond?
Well, indeed, they justify this. And again, I will put it this way, that when you look at countries around the world that have infrastructure that is world-class, they look also at their debt profile. You will find a very strong correlation between countries having very solid infrastructure and also high debt profile. That's on the one side. Now, the other side of it is infrastructure is not something you develop with revenue. Really, the way it works is that you look at infrastructure projects and you have them in two categories, those that are bankable and those that are not bankable. So the typical policy framework is implement the ones that are not bankable with yearly revenue drawings from your budget. And then, of course, the ones that are bankable, you make them available for implementation under the public-private partnership model of execution. So that way, those projects are commercial in nature. And so if you build roads under that model, then the roads can be towed, and of course the private investors will get their monies out. But the infrastructure is there for so many years. And of course, we've seen that play out. In fact, I always give them the example of China, which I gave to our federal government 10 years ago.
Okay.
And that was a plan for 30 years, running from 2004 to 2034.
We'd like to thank you. Thank you for your thoughts, for joining us out of your tight schedule this time. Dr. Biodun Adedipe, who is an economist.